In Santa Clarita, has three right lanes shut down, still 5 south of Pasco Road Boulevard, and traffic stops at Magic Mountain Parkway. Got a vehicle stalled in Santa Clarita, this one on the 14 southbound at Placerita Canyon Road. Mid lane blocked off there, so watch for heavy delays starting at Via Princesa. And they're trying to clear a crash in Encino, 101 southbound near Havenhurst. Mid lane was blocked off. They're trying to push that to the right hand shoulder. Right now, those are slow drive from Tampa Avenue. Crash reported in South Pasadena, left lane blocked off the 110 southbound past Orange Grove Avenue.
Ready to take control of your phone plan? Well, then you better take that next turn to a Verizon store. Because My Plan from Verizon is the kind of control we all deserve. Get exactly what you want. Only pay for what you need. Get My Plan at your Verizon store today.
This is the KBLA Sports Minute with Ray Richardson.
The Denver Nuggets will have to wait a little while longer to find out their opponent in the NBA Finals. Boston avoided a sweep in the Eastern Conference Finals with a 17-point win in Miami. Miami has a 3-1 lead, but the series now goes back to Boston for Game 5 Thursday night. The Lakers hope key moves in the offseason will convince LeBron not to retire. LeBron wants to see what the Lakers would do to improve the team before deciding on his future. Unrestricted free agents on the Lakers roster include D'Angelo Russell, Jared Vanderbilt, Dennis Schroeder, Lonnie Lowe IV, and Troy Brown Jr. Congrats to Golden State Steph Curry for being named the winner of the Kareem Abdul-Jabbar Social Justice Champion Award. The award comes with a $100,000 donation for Curry to give to the charity of his choice. No debates, no speculation, just the info you need. That's your KBLA Sports Minute. I'm Ray Richardson. More news, opinions, and conversation when we come forward on KBLA Talk 1580.
We begin top story with late breaking news.
Is it going to succeed? Yes or no?
I think it's going to succeed.
Can you believe it?
Y'all did it.
KBLA Talk 1580 is about to celebrate its second anniversary on Juneteenth. And no terrible twos around here. We couldn't be more excited about all the good news we'll be announcing soon, including the launch of some new shows to keep giving you more of what you've been looking for.
Come on!
Smart radio for smart people. Hey, it's our celebration, but you get all the gifts. We'll be giving away fresh merch, swag bags, and a chance for you to join the private invitation-only star-studded music and dance till you drop food and drink galore's second anniversary celebration. To stay in the know about the second anniversary details, download the KBLA Talk 1580 app right now. Don't miss out on your chance to be a winner. At KBLA Talk 1580, when we come forward, we're bringing everybody with us.
Happy anniversary, KBLA!
Super. Good. Inglewood. Purple rain falling down on the prince of the coast where the sunshine all year round. Purple haze over landscape, still I hydrate in the lunch line. With the smog and clouds, what? Start me out. This song's in the key of life, and love is in need of more. Young from Inglewood, barefoot on the cedar floor. If black music is the blood, then my heart has been beating more. Rapidly, happily, I look back on a Phoenix Shakur. Her son paved the way, now all eyes on me. Cause I'm young, black, and gifted, Nina, all eyes gon' see. If you swung back when faced with a challenge that's meant to break you and balance scales, you ain't average, now throw your hands on three. Gon' put them up for black magic,
black excellence, black habits, this black medicine, everything black.
Black chucks, black chucks, everything.
Everything black.
Black hug, black love, everything.
Praise black Jesus, play black Moses. Give them flowers while they still give black roses. Everything black.
Black child, black ride, everything.
Everything black.
Black pride, black lives, everything.
KBLA Talk 1580.
Here you are,
black. I'm Dominique DePrima. And I'm so pleased to welcome in today for a daily deep dive a professor of cultural anthropology, sociology, and African American studies at Duke University. Got his BS from Portland State University, a doctorate in anthropology from Temple. He's been a resident fellow at Harvard's W.E.B. Du Bois Institute, the Smithsonian's National Museum of American History, John Hopkins Institute for Global Studies, and so much more. Welcome, 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 Dr. Lee D. Baker.
Good morning. It is such an honor and pleasure to be part of your show.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that a lot. It's an honor and a pleasure to have you here. And you, I know you well know that we have an ongoing and serial conversation because one of my big things that I talk about is this idea that we, particularly Black people, but all people, especially Americans, need to know the difference between race, ethnicity, nationality, culture. And I think most of us don't.
I think that's right. And it's so much context dependent. And so when people just throw around the term race, they don't, oftentimes they're thinking about identity or culture. And these need to be sort of parsed out and understood sort of in their specific context.
I mean, you've written a lot about race and culture, right? I mean, Anthropology and the Racial Politics of Culture, that's a book I need to crack, that you wrote back in 2010. And so when you talk about context, is that what you mean? You're talking about culture within the culture? Are you talking about geographic? You're talking about occupational? Like, there's so many different contexts that sort of put a spin. Historical, okay.
Is one, and sometimes it's just the social context as well. But race as a social construct has changed over time and has evolved and continues to evolve in this country in specific ways, but in other countries as well.
So give me an example of what you mean by the evolution of race.
So early in colonial Virginia, for example, there were a series of certain laws that unfolded to make enslaved people chattel property. And so one of the first ones was children born to Negro women were either free or slaves, depending on their mother's status. And if you think about English common law, which was driven so much about Virginia, everything in terms of property was about the man. So if you shift it to a woman, that was pretty important.
Yeah.
But because people were systematically and sort of raped through like industrial terrorism, they couldn't do that because it would have gone against their property rights. So they wanted more enslaved Africans. That was a big law. And then in 1705, for example, all Negro, mulatto, and Indian slaves within this dominion shall be held and taken and adjudicated as real estate. 1705, that's kind of late in the colonial period.
Yeah.
And so these evolved. And then one of my favorite ones of Virginia colonial law was, yes, you could, you had the liberty to free your slaves, but you had to get them out of the Commonwealth of Virginia. They had to go to Pennsylvania and North Carolina, not in Virginia.
Oh, you can free your slaves, but they can't be free over here.
They can't be free in Virginia.
Wow. It seems like Virginia continues to carry on some of those traditions.
Indeed.
In some ways today. So when you
and then those laws just kind of get compounded. And then after Bacon's Rebellion, they become even more stringent. And so this idea that an actual person could be bought and sold, and then their children are also your property, emerged over time.
Okay, see, this is what I was going to ask you, because when you talked about this idea that children born to Black women were enslaved or free based on the status of the mom, which is a huge shift to sort of some kind of matrilineal system, that was meant to keep the children of enslaved women also enslaved.
Correct.
So if it was based on the status of the father, if they were raping the women, then technically those children would be free, which weirdly I found out that when I went to Tanzania in the Arab world, when the children were born, when the moms were raped or there's some kind of arrangement and the child is born with a, you know, enslaver as a father and the slave as the mother, the child is free, right? And becomes part of the family, the white person or the enslaving person's family. And the mom stays enslaved. That made my head explode because I started thinking about all the Black blood in all those Arab countries from all those baby mamas that, you know, now their children are part of the family.
Yes, there are many historic ironies that abound.
Yeah, but it also, I mean, I think it highlights what you were just saying about that Virginia law, which means it could have been configured any kind of way. But this is...
Right,
go ahead.
And there were cases where black women became free because their fathers were their owners, for example. It was this case, Elizabeth Key, in 1630. It was, she sued for her freedom, she got her freedom, she won, lost, and then won again. It's just a really interesting case study.
Wow, I'm not familiar with that. That sounds like an amazingly instructive story. So these are the roots of where we are right now. And you're talking about how it resonates today. I want to look a little bit more at that. Talking with Dr. Lee D. Baker, and you know where you are, KBLA, Talk 1580.
The station you turn to when you've had it up to here with cultural incompetence. KBLA Talk 1580.
On Saturday, May 27th and Sunday, May 28th, join Pastor Shep Crawford and other local houses of worship for the Apology Tour. Details about the Saturday, May 27th press conference and the Sunday, May 28th walkout are available at theapologytour.com. The Apology Tour is a united effort to engage the community and serve the least among us by tearing down the walls of division, misunderstanding, and tension between the church and the community. The Apology Tour helps to address the impact of the pandemic, which created a greater distance between the beloved community and the black church. The Apology Tour invites participating local ministries to walk out of the building and into the community for 1 to 4 hours on Sunday, May 28th at 12 noon to provide services and offer giveaways reflective of the community's needs assessment and priorities. For more information or to join this call to action, please visit theapologytour.com, changing the community through the spirit of God's love.
Life is uncertain. It's okay to feel stressed, anxious, worried, or frustrated. It's normal. With CalHope's free and secure mental health resources, it's easy to get the help you and your loved ones need when you need it the most. Call our warm line at 833-317-4673 or live chat at calhope.org today.
I have diabetes. I'm at risk for pneumococcal pneumonia.
I have asthma. I'm at risk too.
If you're 19 or older with chronic conditions like asthma, diabetes, COPD, or heart disease, or are 65 or older, you are at increased risk for pneumococcal pneumonia. Ask your doctor or pharmacist about Prevnar 20, pneumococcal 20-valent conjugate vaccine, a vaccine that can help protect you against pneumococcal pneumonia in just one dose. Even if you've already been vaccinated with other pneumonia vaccines, Prevnar 20 may help provide added protection. Prevnar 20 is approved for adults to help prevent infections from 20 strains of the bacteria that cause pneumococcal pneumonia. Continued approval may depend on a supportive study. Don't get Prevnar 20 if you've had a severe allergic reaction to the vaccine or its ingredients. Adults with weakened immune systems may have a lower response to the vaccine. Side effects include pain and swelling at the injection site, fatigue, headache, muscle, and joint pain. For full prescribing information, please call 1-855-213-2138 or visit Prevnar20.com.
Thanks for waking up with Dominique DePrima on KBLA Talk 1580.
And a fascinating conversation which you are invited into, 800-920-1580. We're talking with Dr. Lee D. Baker. Among his several books that he's written, Life in America, Identity and Everyday Experience, and Anthropology and the Racial Politics of Culture. Dr. Baker, you know, we've been having this conversation about whether it is okay to say BIPOC or people of color, marginalized. People, a lot of black folks are not feeling that. They want to center blackness. They want to look at remedies. We want to look at remedies to blackness. And the oppression of black people, anti-blackness remedies is what I mean. And I do as well, but I'm also a coalition person. And I think our sense of justice, our sense of seeking justice is right on target. But our understanding of the sort of origins and the role of race is not always so clear, right? So a lot of people get mad at me for saying that I don't believe in race. Race is a social construct. I'm not saying we're post-racial or that we're not oppressed on the basis of race. I'm saying that it was something that was just made up to enforce this hierarchy, this American hierarchy, which puts us at the bottom, well, a global hierarchy, I should say. How do you view that? Do you think it's a made-up thing? How do you see the concept
no,
of race?
No, I've admired the sophisticated way that you've been able to think through sort of race, culture, identity, ethnicity, nationality, and because they're subtly different, but all driven by a lot of the same dynamics. I think what's really important is for people to understand sort of why race evolved in the way that it did, particularly in the 1820s, which I think is a hugely important time period in the United States, particularly in the South, because this is at once Indian removal for sovereign land and sort of the re-enslavement of Blacks on the sort of cotton as king, sort of. So you move out Indians in Georgia and Alabama, and you move in new cotton plantations to make cotton king. And then and that's the height of the slave trade in the United States.
And so you're saying that
the domestic slave trade. There's like almost two trail of tears. One, removing Indians to Oklahoma, and then all the broke tobacco plantations had to sell off their slaves, and they were re-enslaved in the cotton kingdom of Alabama and Georgia.
Mm.
And that movement, both, I mean, at the same time, really reinscribed new notions of race for both the so-called civilized tribes, right, who also had enslaved Africans, ironically, but that Indian removal and then that sort of second trail of tears of the re-enslaved people that got sold, quote, down the river, those were people moving from Virginia down to Alabama and Georgia to be on the cotton plantation.
The Water Dancer by Ta-Nehisi Coates kind of touches on that a little bit. Those broke plantation owners. But how did our ideas about race change during this double trail of tears, as you're calling it?
Well, because at that time too, a new type of brutal slavery was happening, and dehumanization had to be part of that. If you're selling children from their mother, you have to have an idea of dehumanization. And in some respects, particularly in the Maryland and Virginia plantations, they used the threat of selling your children or your spouse to conform behavior. But again, sometimes they were so leveraged in terms of finances, they had to sell their property. But dehumanization becomes an increasingly part of this. And, you know, it's always a little tricky because you could say, was a cotton plantation worse than a tobacco plantation? What we do know is that there were generations of families that were on these long-term, like, tobacco plantations. And so you knew people. You could trust people. You knew who was a scoundrel. You knew who was, you know, a relative. You almost had intergenerational reciprocity, you know. But then when you are removed and sold to someplace else, you're a new person and you don't know people. You don't have kin. You don't know who to trust. And so that level of sort of alienation on those cotton plantations increased loneliness, increased crazy. You were not connected in the same way.
Yeah. I mean, in whatever underground resources or comforts there might have been, scarce as they may have been, are now removed from you as well.
Right.
Yeah.
And so those that, I mean, these just you compound, and then you get Reconstruction. And then you get the flashback or the retraction of Reconstruction in the 1890s. And that's when, I think the 1820s and 1890s were super important because that's, again, another moment of dehumanization where, you know, there was an incentive not to kill enslaved Africans, because they were your property, after Reconstruction, there was no incentive at all. And that's when you get the lynchings, kind of systematic, terrorized lynchings.
So, I mean,
I call it industrial terrorism.
Yeah, I heard that phrase. It was the first I'd heard of it, but it certainly makes sense. Because it's on-the-job rape, if you will. Even though you're not getting paid, you're enslaved. On-the-job murder. So how do you see these kinds of, you know, dehumanizations and these kinds of constructs of race playing out right now?
Well, I think there are elements, particularly, I think people are trying, but when these black boys are just getting gunned down by police officers, that's not empathy. That's kind of dehumanization.
Yeah. Okay. So and standing on that foundation of legal, legal and then social dehumanization that you're tracing back to these Virginia laws, and then again to the sort of leveling up the brutality in the 1820 and 1890s periods.
Mm-hmm.
So when I talk about understanding, where this comes from, is that where you take the origins of race, or does it go back further than that?
There's a lot of human diversity.
Right.
And anthropologists won't say that there's not, but race is just a kind of a crappy way of organizing it. So religion difference, cultural differences go back a long ways. I mean, obviously, and there's different cultural rituals and all that sort of stuff. But race as a social construct, as a legal construct, is a modern entity that kind of comes out. I and the people debate this, put it kind of in the Enlightenment.
Okay, and based on what?
Again, based on trying to maximize black labor in indigenous land.
Right. So,
That's Thomas Jefferson was kind of, thinking creatively about this. And even when a lot of people don't know this, when he was penning the Declaration of Independence, when he aspirationally thought that, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. The first draft of this, and we've got this on, you can go to the constitutional website and see this, it says, "We hold these truths to be sacred and undeniable, that all men are created equal and independent." Now, it was Benjamin Franklin that told Tommy Jeff, "You better dial that back a bit, you slaveholder." Because it would just be too kind of contradictory, even though it was supposed to be aspirational at the time. So they deleted sacred and undeniable.
Just self-evident. Self-evident is good, right?
And they said self-evident's good enough.
Self-evident works. I like that.
Deleted independent. So we are created equal and not and independent.
Just
I'm happy
equal.
To send the PDF over to your listeners.
Yeah. Well, you know what? Yeah, I'm sure folks will be on the Constitutional website. I've never heard that before. That's really telling, isn't it, about the kind of negotiation they were doing internally at how this would land and be interpreted.
Right. Even when, Thomas Jefferson's in Philadelphia penning this with, his enslaved helper right along with him. I mean, the irony is just stunning. Mm.
And so then when we talk about blackness as community, we talk about black community, black pride, black excellence, black habits, black everything. We have cleaved by necessity, by political reality, and now by culture to this idea of our blackness.
And so this is where it gets kind of tricky, particularly, you know, I've focused on the Harlem Renaissance or the New Negro Movement, and there is a moment where segregation turns into congregation, and it's not necessarily by, it is by choice. And so, you know, culture, identity, family, communities come together, not because of racialized segregation, but because of more empowered congregation.
Right. Like Leimert Park, where we're broadcasting from today. And that's when we get mad about gentrification, because my thing is, can't we have nice things? Like, why you all got to come over here and try to get what you forced us into, and then we created a beautiful thing about it? But I guess that's kind of where you, when you talk about tricky, right? Because...
Right, Dominica, that is the story of America. We build nice stuff, and then they come and take it.
Right.
I mean,
yeah. So then, I mean, so, and here's the irony too, because I consider myself pro-black. I'm not a nationalist, but I consider myself pro-black. But I also don't believe in the construct of race. And that's why I say we have to know race, ethnicity, culture, nationality. And you say identity. How do you define identity in that list of, you know, of elements that we're dealing with here?
So identity, yes, it's sort of how one actually identifies. And this, again, it gets kind of tricky because there's increasingly sort of a lot of biracial people that identify as biracial. I think a generation ago, there was just the one drop and you just a black vote. But there is a growth, particularly among like students, I see that. I don't want to dismiss that.
Okay, but I do. I hate that. My mom was white. My dad is black. I'm black. I live in America. We still have the one drop rule. Not that I want to be defined by, you know, laws and theories that were meant to oppress me. But what's good for black people in America is good for you if you're visibly and probably even invisibly black. And so I don't like biracial. It rubs me the wrong way.
I'm with you. I'm in the same boat. But I'm around a lot of students these days.
Right.
That they are pushing this, and I'm not in a position to dismiss it. And that's the example I'm providing as people stitch together distinctive identities. Sometimes it doesn't match reality. Oftentimes it does.
So, identity is how we define ourselves.
Yes, but there's also a component of how the community identifies you.
Hello.
Because there's a lot of what we call pretendians. They're Native Americans. They may have gotten a DNA test or something, and it's difficult. They cannot just say, oh, I am this type of indigenous sovereign tribe. That tribe has to claim you as well.
Mm.
And that's what I mean by identity. It's sort of,
right.
It's not just you identifying yourself. There has to be some reciprocity engaged in that.
Yeah, we only have 30 seconds till news, traffic, and sports, but you're leading me over here to the Rachel Dolezal territory where, you know, people now want to say there's such a thing as transracial and biracial, and that's why I just push back. There's one race to me. It's human. But then you do have ethnicity. You do have culture. You do have a nationality and I guess identity. I guess I've been leaving that one out, Dr. Lee. But I want to, you know, I want to get your take on why that is or isn't a thing when we come forward on KBLA Talk 1580.
More of First Things First with Dominique DePrima when we come forward. I'm Ray Harris, and here's the latest from the Black Information Network.
President and Speaker McCarthy had a productive meeting about the need to prevent a default and avoid a catastrophe for our economy.
GOP negotiators say a significant gap remains between Republicans and Democrats as they discuss raising the debt ceiling.
It is not going to deal with the problem that we're currently having at this moment.
Negotiators from the White House and Speaker McCarthy's office are continuing to meet to try and come to an agreement before June 1st. The days of Netflix subscribers sharing their passwords are coming to an end. The streamer began emailing customers about its new password policy. Netflix noted that some subscribers in the same household will still be able to stream wherever they are, including at hotels and vacation homes. And that's the latest. I'm Ray Harris on the Black Information Network and BINnews.com.
Siglett in Santa Clarita has three right lanes shut down, still five south of Pasco Road Boulevard, and traffic stops at Magic Mountain Parkway. Got a vehicle stalled in Santa Clarita, this one on the 14 southbound at Placerita Canyon Road. Mid lane blocked off there, so watch for heavy delays starting at Via Princesa. And they're trying to clear a crash in Encino, 101 south under Havenhurst. Mid lane was blocked off. They're trying to push that to the right hand shoulder. Right now, though, it's a slow drive from Tampa Avenue. Crash reported in South Pasadena, left lane blocked off the 110 south past Orange Grove Avenue.
Ready to take control of your phone plan? Well, then you better take that next turn to a Verizon store. Because my plan from Verizon is the kind of control we all deserve. Get exactly what you want. Only pay for what you need. Get my plan at your Verizon store today.
This is the KBLA Sports Minute with Ray Richardson.
The Denver Nuggets will have to wait a little while longer to find out their opponent in the NBA Finals. Boston avoided a sweep in the Eastern Conference Finals with a 17-point win in Miami. Miami has a 3-1 lead, but the series now goes back to Boston for Game 5 Thursday night. The Lakers hope key moves in the offseason will convince LeBron not to retire. LeBron wants to see what the Lakers would do to improve the team before deciding on his future. Unrestricted free agents on the Lakers roster include D'Angelo Russell, Jared Vanderbilt, Dennis Schroeder, Lonnie Lowe IV, and Troy Brown Jr. Congrats to Golden State Steph Curry for being named the winner of the Kareem Abdul-Jabbar Social Justice Champion Award. The award comes with a $100,000 donation for Curry to give to the charity of his choice. No debates, no speculation, just the info you need. That's your KBLA Sports Minute. I'm Ray Richardson. More news, opinions, and conversation when we come forward on KBLA Talk 1580.
Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States of America.
The story of Emmett Till and his mother is a story of a family's promise and loss in a nation's reckoning with hate, violence, and abuse of power. It's a story that was seared into our memory and our conscience, the nation's conscience, when Mrs. Till insisted that an open casket for her murdered and maimed 14-year-old son. She said, "Let the people see what I've seen." The reason the world saw what she saw was because of another hero in this story, the Black Press, Jet Magazine, the Chicago Defender, and other Black radio and newspapers were unflinching and brave in making sure America saw what she saw. Ida B. Wells once said, and I quote, "The way to right wrongs is to turn the light of truth upon the wrongs."
Turning the light of truth upon the wrongs. We're unapologetically progressive. KBLA Talk 1580, and we don't black down. KBLA Talk 1580, we've got a lot to talk about.
Maisha Cairo here with a quick recap from my time at JP Morgan Chase's Advancing Black Wealth Tour. There were speakers Ian Dunlap, Damon John, Lynn Richardson, MC Light, Dom Kennedy, to name a few. Take a listen to what Justin Grant, Community Development Lead at Chase's Advancing Black Pathway, let's see what he had to say.
So I'm Justin Grant. I lead community development and national partnerships for JP Morgan Chase's Advancing Black Pathway strategy. And so we're focused on strengthening the economic foundation of Black communities, and we're making targeted investments in programs like the Advancing Black Wealth Tour to help us get our tools and resources out to the community to drive sustained impact over time.
So when it comes to Black and brown people, it sounds like Chase is making it their personal responsibility not only to facilitate these events, but to educate and provide resources. So, Mr. Grant, I have to ask, what does wealth building look like for the individual?
It's home ownership. It's having that freedom to be able to start your own business and create jobs in your community. And it's having that long-term plan towards retirement. Having that vision for what you want your life to be, and you have the resources to actually live it.
I'm Aisha Cairo. Thanks for sticking around. That was my recap from Chase's Advancing Black Wealth Tour. First stop was here in LA, and they're taking it national.
Did you know that all City of LA renters have rights? Check out these three facts. Residential tenants can't be evicted without reason or just cause. Eviction protection still exists for unpaid COVID-19 rental debt due before March 31st, 2023. And you have 5 days to respond to an eviction notice. 5 days. Many Angelenos may be at risk of losing their home, and that's why we want you to know your rights. Learn more at housing.lacity.org. Be informed. Be protected. Be at home.
Broadcasting live from Lombard Park, USA. Welcome back to your home for unapologetically progressive radio, KBLA Talk 1580.
Yes, we are talking with Professor Dr. Lee D. Baker. He's a professor of cultural anthropology, sociology, and African American studies. He's also an author. Right now, he is at Duke University. Got a bunch of books. I've been on Amazon ordering them during news, traffic, and sports because sharing some really important information. And before news, traffic, and sports, I asked you about, you know, we were talking about biracial, a term I reject, but I agree with you. I've met lots of younger folks that use it, and I'm not going to tell them how to. I listen to Neely Fuller. You call people what they want to be called. I'll challenge it, but I'll call them what they want to be called. But what about a step further, transracial, and why is that or isn't it a thing, which most of us sort of reject just on a gut level, the Rachel Dolezals of the world?
Yeah. So as an anthropologist, you know, we study humans sort of past and present, and sometimes going all the way past. So technically, every human is of African descent.
Right.
But they're not black. And so it becomes, again, kind of like technically a little bit tricky. But when you're talking about politics and identity, a lot of times, and race is often political, you have to deal with white supremacy, white privilege, and the lack thereof. And then once you start looking at that, then it's really hard for me, again, personally and politically, to sort of go down that road. Because yeah. I think there is this sort of community element. It's about, no matter how much you identify, and you can be enculturated and socialized. If I grew up in Japan, was socialized, knew the language, knew the religion, the Japanese people probably wouldn't embrace me as Japanese.
Right.
So there's that sort of reciprocity piece to it.
I mean, that might not be the greatest example, or maybe it is the perfect example, because I have one friend that calls them an ethno state. I mean, everyone in Japan, mostly everyone, looks a certain way, right? Not like UK or France or something where you have people that look black that are French, and, you know, I think that's why where it gets confusing. Because, as you just said, I always say, technically, we're all black. And Dr. Richard King, the great psychiatrist, used to say, it's about your relationship to your blackness. Because we're all African. But, as you said, we're not all black. And since race is based on phenotype, it's really based on how you look. Right?
Well, that's why it was a little bit tricky when I used Japan as an example, because that would be a national identity.
Right.
But a lot of times they kind of might think it's racialized too, but nevertheless, that would be a nationality.
It's a nationality that happens to be a place that, you know, they don't, there's not a lot of immigrants there. Mostly everybody in Japan, you know, looks like they're from Japan, according to our idea
and
of what Japanese
people
are.
And even the Koreans that are there still being discriminated against after all these years.
Well, yeah, but I mean, that's now you're talking about the sociopolitical part, the conflicts between Japan and Korea go way back.
Right.
So that's why I say, you know, most of us can't name, most of us will say a race. They'll say they're biracial or black or whatever they think they are. And then that's where it breaks down. Ethnicity. To me, ethnicity is where your people are from, right? What does that mean to you, ethnicity?
Yeah, that's what it means to me as well. So there's a lot of people that can be African-American, but they're Jamaican ethnicity, or they come from the islands, or and even in like Ghana, you know, the Ewe language group, I would put that kind of as an ethnicity.
Mm.
So there's just even different ethnicities within a single African country. They might call them language groups. Other people might call them tribes. I like to think that's more like an ethnicity.
Okay. So for me, as an African-American who has an Italian-American mother, to me, my ethnicity is African-American, Italian-American, right?
Absolutely.
What is nationality?
And those are your cultural, those are some of your cultural landmarks or orientations.
So your culture does overlap with ethnicity, but not necessarily the same, right? Because my culture is also Leimert Park. It's hip hop. It's Bay Area. It's
right.
Progressive political thinker. It's feminist. All of those are part, to me, those are all part of my culture. That don't have anything to do necessarily with my ethnicity.
Yes. And when I think in culture, I'm thinking more like cultural and ethnicity overlapping, not inclusive of sort of popular culture. But
right.
That's a good way of thinking.
But I'm actually trying to get you to help me to be smarter about this, because to me, there is this overlap, and that's part of what makes it confusing. If I say my race is black, but my ethnicity is black and Italian, then I just said the same thing twice, or African-American and Italian.
So you can say your heritage.
Right, but heritage and ethnicity, are they different?
They can be.
Yeah. So we have to be more nuanced. I mean, it sounds like we have to be more
and
nuanced.
And that's what I was saying, even in the beginning, it's all about sort of context.
Okay, so let's say...
you can talk about the Igbo and Yoruba ethnicities in Nigeria.
Right.
And those overlap, and those are also heritages.
And for us, they're just Nigerians. And for some people, they're just black people. But if you know that Igbo and Yoruba have often been at odds.
Right.
Throughout their histories. So those would be very different ethnicities if you're Nigerian or African or educated about that. That said, to me, I can say I'm African-American or black and Italian, but the fact culture is also who you are, right? It's what accent do you talk with? It's what food do you eat? It's what music do you listen to? So to me, that's culture, but it has to do with who you are as well. It's part of your identity, right?
That's correct.
Yeah, so I'm getting really confused. Although,
that's what I'm saying. It is a little confusing.
I had this all worked out, Dr. Lee, and then you came in and messed it all up. But no, I mean, I think this is what we have to do, right? If we're going to get real about knowing what we know and even defining ourselves and our struggles. Nationality is...
And there's overlap. I mean, that's the other thing. I mean, you're in L.A., so like... The Asian community is so complex, and they have various ethnicities, the Hmong, the Cambodians, the Vietnamese, the Indonesians, goodness gracious. Those are all sort of ethnic groups, but they all are constructed as Asian American.
In race.
Racially, yes.
Racially. So that's a good example. Racially, they would be, we put them all in the basket of Asian. Ethnically, they have all these different groups, Korean, Japanese, Hmong, Cambodian,
Filipino.
Don't forget. Yeah, Filipino, right? And then nationality, if they're born here, they're USA. It's what nationality is easy because that's what it says on your passport.
Right.
But culturally, it becomes more complicated again because you're going to have overlap with, am I Vietnamese? Do I live in East LA or... South Central, what is my orientation to America? That's beyond just my ethnicity or my race. That has to do with the specifics.
Right.
And then what about, and then what about identity? That says I call myself this or, how does identity fit into that? What we just outlined.
Yeah, I mean, and one can identify as anything you'd like.
Pretty much.
But in order for it, I hate to use this word authentic, so I probably even won't. But in order for it to be meaningful,
right?
People have to claim you and identify you as that as well.
Okay. So that makes sense. There's a reciprocity to identity.
There's a reciprocity.
Mm. All right. We're talking with Dr. Lee D. Baker, and you know where you are. We are centering black and progressive voices all day long. We are KBLA Talk 1580.
She's reclaiming her time on KBLA Talk 1580. More First Things First with Dominic DePrima when we come forward.
The California versus hate campaign launches at the state capitol. Maisha Cairo here with your KBLAC Minute News, brought to you by CaliforniaBlackMedia.org. California versus hate. It's a new website and telephone hotline created to address the sharp rise in hate crimes and incidents occurring in California. It's a tool state residents can use to report crimes motivated by racial, ethnic, or other identity biases. According to an address by Lauren Pryor, president of the Black Youth Leadership Project, anti-Black or African-American-based events rose from 456 in 2020 to 513 in 2021, a 12.5% increase. Reports can be made online at cavshate.org or by calling 833-8-NO-HATE, Monday through Friday with staff trained in over 200 languages.
In our community, mental health struggles can sometimes go unnoticed. The suicide rate among Black youth has risen faster than any other ethnic group. Only one in three African Americans who need mental health care receives it. African American women are only half as likely as their Caucasian counterparts to seek professional mental health services. Even those who guide us spiritually can sometimes face their own challenges. 45% of pastors say they've experienced depression or burnout to the extent they need to take a leave of absence from ministry. As people of faith, it's time to acknowledge it's okay not to be okay. You can pray and get help. Visit normalizehelp.org for more information and resources. Join us in raising mental health awareness in our community. Funded by the Los Angeles County Department of Mental Health and the Champion Counseling Center of Faithful Central Bible Church.
When you're young, life is full of choices. Don't let opioids like highly addictive and deadly fentanyl take away your life and your choices with just one wrong pill. Addiction is a disease that can affect anyone at any age, but there is a choice to get help for this disease. Find medically proven treatment options, including virtual, at choosemat.org.
KBLA Talk 1580 is in the lab right now, prepping some new shows coming your way soon. More empowerment, more inspiration, more entertainment. More entertainment.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Jazz Urban Hour. I'm your host, Bill Banfield. We are a curated musical show that highlights contemporary cultural issues and artistry, showcasing music as a relevant and necessary arm of contemporary cultural identity.
You must learn.
Welcome. I am your host, Dr. Tyrone Howard on KBLA Talk 1580, and you're listening to You Must Learn, where we talk about education as a tool for transformation. Education in our homes, in our schools, and in our communities. Education for Transformation is the tagline, and we are here to talk about why we must learn.
KBLA Talk 1580 is for discerning listeners just like you. So tell all your friends you've discovered the talk station curating smart content for smart people. We're KBLA Talk 1580, and we've got your black. This is KBLA Talk 1580, where hate meets a scholarly match.
Yeah, I love this idea, Dr. Lee D. Baker, of the reciprocity in identity. And the reason I say that is because, you know, if you look at social media right now, all these people that think they're funny are saying, you know, I identify as this and I identify as that. You know, I'm transportation or I'm transparent or whatever. And so there's this idea which is based on, I think, really transphobia, if I'm being honest, when we talk about, you know, transgender people, that you can identify as anything. And I think it's a way of people saying that if you're a transgender person, you're not really, if you identify as a woman, you're not really a woman, or you identify as a man, you're not really a man. So I say I identify as a, you know, a mountain, or the really common one is I identify as invisible. So I'm transparent. Ha ha ha. But The thing about that is, you know, right, when you're, or this idea that anybody can just say they're black and that means they're black. So when you talk about some kind of reciprocity, you're talking about some acknowledgement that, but that also sounds tricky if I'm, if I am a transgender person and I'm dealing with people that are homophobic, they say, no, you're not a woman, even though you identify as a woman and you've been through these, you know, all these different psychological and physiological regimens to become fully a woman, then I don't recognize that. So that means you're not. So you know what I'm, you know what I'm saying? So how does that, how does that piece play into the reciprocity piece?
It's not exactly, I mean, gender and culture, well, I should say maybe race and sex don't, are not like one-on-one. You can't, they're not equivalent in that
right.
sense.
Right, apples so and oranges.
On the the reciprocity piece is about community and living a life where you are with other people that you identify with, which is, and so I do think that reciprocity piece is part of it.
I think it's really important too,
or can be an important part of it.
Yeah, especially in the example that you use, which is Indigenous people. It seems like there's tons of folks from the dominant group, people who identify themselves or would be identified by society and privileged by society as white, who are now claiming to be Indigenous.
Right.
And so your example was that if there's no community anywhere that also recognizes that, it's problematic. And I think what you said just helped me understand the reaction to Elizabeth Warren, for example, who I love, when she was talking about her Indigenous heritage and people were rejecting of that. And I was like, why? It's showing up in her DNA. But what you're saying is that she wasn't also reciprocated by any Indigenous community. So that questions the legitimacy of that?
Correct.
Mm. So,
and particularly because they have like sovereign nations.
Right.
Like you are a citizen of, or you're not.
Right.
And so, you know, if you're not sort of an enrolled citizen, then it's hard to be able to claim your identity be along those lines.
Okay, but two things about
although
that.
Although some people do.
Right, and some of those sovereign nations have been reluctant or outright racist about including, you know, black Indians. So
that's
what do you,
true.
You know, then you get into the politics of community in identity.
Very quickly. Particularly then you'd be a free, like we would call them the freemen of these particular tribes.
Right.
Or sovereign nations.
Right. And then there are some Indigenous groups that have never been recognized, but certainly they have the cultural and historical
right.
claim to their heritage.
Right.
Well, it's good for us to think about these things. It stretches our brains and makes us, I think, better understand who we are. We're talking with Dr. Lee D. Baker. When we come forward, I have a few minutes before we pass the microphone to Mr. Tavis Smiley. And I just want to pass it to you, Dr. Baker, and say, like, what do you want us to really think about? What do you want us to ponder? What would you leave us with on this beautiful Wednesday? I'm Dominique DePrima, and this is KBLA Talk 1580.
Say the quiet part out loud. KBLA Talk 1580.
Have you faced discrimination in Los Angeles? The City of LA Civil Rights Department can help. They investigate private sector discrimination in LA City in commerce, education, employment, and housing. If you're facing discrimination, submit a complaint online for free at laisforeveryone.com. That's laisforeveryone.com or call 213-978-1845.
Hey, Dad, how do airplanes fly? What's in this box? Is this tree good for climbing? How are babies made? What does this thing do?
Kids are curious about everything, including guns. Talking to them about gun safety in your home is a good first step, but you can do more. always keep your guns locked, unloaded, and stored separately from ammunition. Safe gun storage saves lives. Learn how to make your home safer at nfamilyfire.org. That's nfamilyfire.org. Brought to you by N Family Fire, Brady, and the Ad Council.
At Charmin, we heard you shouldn't talk about going to the bathroom in public, so we decided to sing about it.
Roll Charmin Ultra Strong when you drop in the beat. It cleans way less effort on your seat. Yeah, roll it, drop it. Yeah, roll it, drop it. Charmin flows extra strong from the rope. Your butt hella clean while you're sitting on the bowl, yeah. It's all you need for that bathroom groove. Get you in and out without nothing to prove.
Charmin Ultra Strong cleans better so you can use less. Enjoy the go with Charmin.
We've got a lot to talk about.
Hi, I'm Ray Richardson, your sports connection here at KBLA Talk 1580. Join me and my co-host Neil Scarborough every Saturday night at 7 for Out of Bounds, the show that brings some flavor to the world of sports for 60 minutes. We take you beyond the scores and press conferences. We give you our point of view, the way black folks see what's going down. You can join the conversation and give us your analysis at 1-800-920-1580. Out of Bounds, every Saturday night at 7 on KBLA Talk 1580. We've got a lot to talk about.
Unapologetically progressive. KBLA Talk 1580. We've got your black.
You like your style, though.
The conversation continues right now. Dominique DePrima on First Things First.
And we're talking with Dr. Lee D. Baker. He's an author, but also a professor of cultural anthropology, sociology, and African American studies at Duke University. Dr. Baker, what are you going to plant in our minds this morning?
So I'm going to put it right back to you. I think you and your team on First Things First constitute a great community. I mean, and so much of our everyday experience is through community, but community is how we think about ourselves together. And your show brings us together in an amazing ways. Even for us that are not in LA, I feel like I'm part of the community because of your show.
Thank you for that. You know, we do have a lot of folks that listen across the country and even across the world, because we have that app. And even the conversation about what is our community has been interesting, because as you have heard, black people are stepping up and saying, no, KBLA is ours. We don't want to share it. We don't want to be unapologetically progressive. We want to be unapologetically black. And I always say it's the black house, but all are welcome. Not the White House, it's the black house, my kitchen, my table, my rules, but all are welcome. How do you see that?
I think it's perfect, and I think you're really doing that. And I mean, just all the way going back to Nicole Hannah Jones, the 1619 part, black Americans have made America great in really important ways. We're the most, I mean, and KBLA can make radio great as well. But all should be welcome, but you've got to center the blackness, and you do that perfectly well with your show. You make community.
Thank you. That's a beautiful compliment. Dr. Lee D. Baker, how can we follow you?
Oh, I am on Instagram and Twitter, but not much.
go to your local bookstore and get one of the books. How about that?
Yes,
how about buy a
about
book?
That.
Recycle some black dollars up in here. Well, Dr. Lee D. Baker, it sure has been a pleasure to talk with you.
Oh, it's been a real pleasure. Thank you so much.
As you know, Tavis Smiley is up next. I'll talk to you on social media. Me and Sherry just took some cute pics. I think I'm going to put them up when I come off. In the meantime, I will talk to you soon, as always. History is now, and we are making it together. I'm Dominique DePrima. Until tomorrow, be safe, be well, be in community. One love.
KBLA 1580 Santa Monica.
Discuss raising the debt ceiling.
It is not going to...